Welcome back, and in this lesson, I want to expand on previous Transit Gateway lessons. I want to cover a few advanced concepts and things that you need to know for real-world usage and for your study at this level. Now, we do have a lot to cover, so let's jump in and get started straight away. Now, some of this should be a refresher, but let's go ahead and do it anyway. On screen now, I'm going to show you a pretty typical transit gateway architecture. First, we have two regions, AP Southeast on the left and US East on the right. And inside the AP Southeast 2 region, we create a transit gateway which isn't initially attached to anything. It's a gateway object within the AP Southeast 2 region. Now, transit gateway, as you've learned previously, is a hub and spoke architecture, so it can be connected to various other networking types and networking objects within AWS. For example, VPC1 and VPC2 on the left using VPC attachments. It can also connect to on-premises networks via VPN attachments, where it's used as a termination point for the VPN tunnels rather than a virtual private gateway. It can also integrate with Direct Connect indirectly. Now, to do this, a transit VIF is created rather than a private VIF on a Direct Connect. This goes via a DX gateway, and this DX gateway can attach to the transit gateway. One DX gateway can be attached to 3 transit gateways in this way and provide the DX connection access to all of the things connected to all of those transit gateways. Now, as you'll see soon, this potentially can be many, many VPCs. Now, the transit gateway for all of these attachments has a default route table which is populated with any routes learned from the attachments. So for the VPCs, this is the side arrangers of those VPCs. For the VPNs, it's the routes learned using BGP over the VPN. And for a DX gateway and transit gateway attachment, you define the networks within the attachment configured at the DX gateway side. It's important that you understand, though, this default route table has, by default, all routes which the transit gateway learns about, and by default, the route table is used by all of the attachments of the transit gateway. Now, the last thing I want to mention is that you can peer transit gateways with other transit gateways in different regions. You can peer with up to 50 other transit gateways per transit gateway, and all of those transit gateways can also peer with other transit gateways. So this is what you should already know about the transit gateway product. Let's take a moment to summarize. So a transit gateway by default has one route table. All attachments use this route table to make routing decisions. So as traffic leaves an attachment, it uses the route table that's associated with that attachment. Now, by default, all attachments propagate routes to this single route table. So this means that every attachment adds the routes that it knows about to this default route table. Now, there is an exception to this, and that's peering attachments, but I'll talk more about this later in the lesson. Now, with this kind of configuration, where you have one default route table, where it's associated with every attachment, and every attachment propagates to it, it means that all attachments can route to all other attachments on a single transit gateway. And this, again, is the default configuration. Now, let's talk more about transit gateway peering attachments across regions. So we have the same AP Southeast 2 region and US East 1 regions that I just discussed, and between them, an inter-region peering attachments between the two transit gateways. The transit gateway on the left is connected to the same two VPCs, the DX gateway via a transit VIF and the customer VPN using a VPN attachment. On the right, this transit gateway has a similar set of attachments, only without the Direct Connect. Both sides are adding their learned routes, so the prefixes, to their own default route table, which is added to by all attachments connected to that single transit gateway, and it's used by all attachments on that single transit gateway. Now, what's critical to understand about peering attachments, though, is the routes aren't shared, so the transit gateway on the left isn't passing routes that it knows about to the transit gateway on the right. You need to use static routes to allow this peering to function, and that's much the same as you use when configuring VPC peering. So it's important that you understand that these routes are not advertised from left to right and right to left. You have to configure static routes. Now, AWS are also hinting that there will be future enhancements, and so they recommend when configuring a transit gateway that you use a unique ASN to allow for these future enhancements. Now, I've learned to take AWS advice whenever things are framed in this way, so you should probably do that. If you're configuring any transit gateways, make sure that you configure them with unique ASNs. I do expect at some point in the future that route advertisements will work over transit gateway peering, so it's best to stick with unique ASNs, and that will minimize any future issues which you might experience. Now, it's also worth noting that the resolution of public DNS to private addressing, for example, with EC2, isn't supported over inter-region peers. So remember how with a VPC, if you attempt to resolve the public DNS of an EC2 instance from within the same VPC, it will resolve to the private address. This doesn't currently work over transit gateway peering attachments, and this is more to do with the cross-region nature rather than a transit gateway limitation. And then finally, in addition, much like VPC peering, the data transfer over the peer is encrypted over the global AWS network. Now, there are a number of key points about peering that I want to discuss. Firstly, you can peer up to 50 peering attachments per transit gateway, and these can be in different regions and different AWS accounts. As I just mentioned, the transit gateway is not capable of learning or propagation across this peer, so you can't send automatic route advertisements across an individual peer between two transit gateways, and you need to use static routes in order to allow each transit gateway to be aware of the networks at the other side of the peer. And data is encrypted just like VPC peering. Again, you should expect updates to the transit gateway product, and so it's always best to configure unique ASNs for every transit gateway that you use. Now, next, I want to cover how transit gateways can be used for more advanced routing architectures. I've mentioned this a few times, but in the default mode of transit gateway, you have one route table, and all attachments are associated with the same route table, which means when traffic leaves that attachment destined for somewhere else, the attached route table is used to decide where that traffic goes to. In addition, it's also the default that all attachments propagate to this same single route table, which means that all attachments are aware of all other attachments, and each of them can route to every other attachment. In this example, the route table ends up looking something like this. Each of the side arrangers, so 10.16, 10.17, 10.18, and 10.19, has an attachment object as a target, so the transit gateway knows how to route traffic from every connected attachment to all of the others. Now, you might not want this, and that's what I want to cover as the last thing in this lesson. But right before we do, again, a few key summary points. Attachments can only be associated with one route table, and it's this route table which controls where the traffic goes when it leaves that attachment. A route table, though, can be associated with many different attachments. Now, attachments can propagate, so pass on the routes that they know about, to one or more route tables, even route tables which they're not associated with. And these two mechanics are what allows us to create some fairly advanced isolated routing architectures. You can create hub and spoke networks, multiple of them, inside a single transit gateway for routing isolation. So on the screen, I'm showing the same architecture that I've talked about previously, only it's slightly reformatted so I can talk about routing and routing isolation. I want to really make sure that you understand the difference between two important terms, association and propagation. Association is when a route table is associated with an attachment. An attachment can be associated with one route table, and when associated, the transit gateway uses this route table to route traffic which is leaving that attachment. So if VPC 1 on the left was sending data to VPC 2, the transit gateway would use whatever route table was associated with the VPC 1 attachment to decide where to send that data. So remember, route table associations are used when data is exiting an attachment. It's how the transit gateway decides where to route traffic to. Propagation, on the other hand, is the configuration which controls which route tables will be populated with routes known by the attachments. So in this example, VPC1 is using 10.16.0.0/16. You could configure it to propagate that CIDR range to the route table that it's associated with or other route tables. Propagation controls which route tables learn about routes from which attachments. Now, as I've mentioned, the default is this single route table which all attachments will use, and all attachments are configured to propagate into that route table. But what if you want to isolate networks? In this example, what if you wanted the VPCs, so VPC1 and VPC2, to be able to access the on-premises networks but not each other? You want VPC1 to be able to communicate with the 10.18 and 10.19 networks, but you don't want VPC1 to be able to communicate with VPC2 or vice versa. Generally, when configuring route tables inside Transit Gateway, any attachments or any networks which need to freely communicate will generally use the same route table, and all of them will propagate to that route table. For isolated networks, you'll want to isolate the route tables and the propagations. With this example, we want free communication between the VPCs and the on-premises networks and vice versa. So, we create a route table, and we configure all attachments to propagate to this route table. This means that the route table 7007 looks like this, where it knows about all of the CIDR ranges of all of the different attachments. Then we associate this with only the VPN and Direct Connect Gateway attachments. This means that the on-premises networks can talk to each other, and it means they can talk to the VPCs. What we don't want to do, though, is associate the VPC attachments with this route table, because if we did, they too could communicate with each other as well as all of the on-premises networks. What we need to do is refine what routes they have available, and to do that, we create another route table 1337. Then we set the on-premises attachments to propagate their routes to this route table, which means that it contains the 10.18 and 10.19 CIDR ranges, and then we associate this route table with the VPC attachments. This means that the VPCs can route to the on-premises networks because those attachments are propagating their routes to this route table, but the VPCs can't reach each other because they're not propagating their routes to this route table. In effect, it creates two isolated routing domains. This is where the VPCs can reach the on-premises networks and vice versa, but where the VPCs cannot reach each other. Now, this is really, really critical to understand for the exam, and especially so for real-world usage. So if you need to watch this part of the video again, then do so. You need to understand the difference between association and propagation, and how we've architectured this solution so the VPC attachments use a separate route table which they don't propagate their CIDR ranges into. Remember, route tables are used for outgoing traffic, so the route table that the VPC attachments are using on the left doesn't need to have prefixes for the VPC, because in this example, VPC1 knows its own CIDR range, and we don't want VPC1 to have any awareness of VPC2. And that's why we have an isolated route table which doesn't get propagated to by either of the VPC attachments. Now, that's everything I wanted to cover in this theory lesson. You're going to get the chance to experiment with some of what you've learned in an upcoming demo lesson. But for now, go ahead and complete this video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.